For almost 2 decades, this man has climbed a mountain of trash. He scavenges for anything he can sell or bring to his family.
Yang dipikirin ya begitu, ketakutan aja, takut longsor, takut ya alat berat lah. Bagaimana alat berat bawa sampah sih. Kadang-kadang yang bawa alatnya nggak ketahuan orang gitu.
Rasidin and thousands of others are one of the main ways trash gets sorted, sold, reused, and sometimes recycled here in Indonesia. Many, like Indan, used to be rice farmers, but found they can make twice as much picking trash.
Sampah itu alhamdulillah berkah. Kalau yang sering yang buang makanan itu seperti orang kaya, orang-orang seperti orang-orang tengah gitu.
So what's it like for the thousands of Indonesians who live off of other people's garbage? And how did this informal recycling industry become such a risky business? The Bantargebang landfill near Jakarta is the size of 200 football fields. It's one of the largest in the world. Around 6,000 people live in slums at its base. Indan has been living here for 2 years. At first, he was afraid to eat the food he collected from the mountain. But now,
yang tadi kita nemu itu alhamdulillah enak. Tadi saya nemu semacam wortel, bakso, terus kol.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma barik lana fima rojaktana wa qina adzabannar.
Suapin.
Ya udah pada makan dulu. Enak dari sono juga. Ini dapat mengut.
Pernah sekali saya bawa makanan nyampe sini, tahu-taunya makanan udah enggak layak dimak. Saya umpetin, ketemu sama anak langsung dimakan, jadinya mencret.
A few houses away, Rasidin is getting ready to go out for the day.
Halo, kaos kaki, bolong sepatunya, Bu. Karena apa? Kalau nggak dikasih plastik, pasti tembus ke kaki. Makanya Bapak dikasih plastik.
Kenapa, Pak?
Karena nggak ada duitnya. Mencukup segitu uangnya.
Dulu ya, Bu, ya. Berangkat kerja. Dongain ya, Bu, ya.
Biar badan paling sehat.
Amin.
Berdoa lah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allah, ya Allah, ya Allahku, ya Allah, ya Allah, ya Allah. Mugi-mugi dikabulkan oleh Allah, Allah, ya Allah. Mohon dikabulkan, ya Allah.
1,300 trucks arrive here every day, mostly from Indonesia's capital, Jakarta. People doing this work call themselves bemulung, which translates to scavenger. They work independently, but need permission from the government to enter the landfill. The biggest dangers on the job are the excavators. They are owned and operated by the Jakarta provincial government. They move the trash around so that this mountain doesn't collapse. Danny Kurniawan has been operating one of them for 18 years.
Jadi dengan adanya pemulung lumayan juga sih banyak, banyak fungsinya. Banyak semacam kayak plastik kan dikumpul sama mereka. Jadi mengurangi volume sampah ya dari dia orang. Makanya kita sebagai pekerja di sini ya biasa aja karena posisinya kita di sini udah tahunan ya. Jadi sama pemulung udah kayak keluarga aja. Kita nggak bisa, apalagi posisi malam nih ya. Begitu kita garuk, ada kayu, apa beling, apa batu, ya kan. Kita garuk, kita angkat, tiba-tiba jatuh kena pemulung. Itu resiko saya.
Rasidin had a close call once.
Cara ngindarinya bapak ke bawah, didorong sama bucket. Cuman salahnya ada bangkolan dari nyangkut, ada kayu. Terus kerinjang iketannya itu nyangkut, jadi bapak ngegantung. Nyelametin bapak anak, semua datang.
But he continues to work near them because they usually operate where new trash arrives.
Ya apa aja, botol, tulang, ya seadanya aja di bulog, yang barang pasti dijual gitu.
Recycling facilities mostly take bottles, cardboard, and metal. But local artisans will pay good money for bones to make jewelry.
Ah, dulu mah memang iya masih bawa muntah-muntah. Sekarang mah ya udah, kalau omongan kasar tuh bangbal gitu. Udah tebel, bener ibu. Ya rasanya puyeng. Ya paling kalau udah puyeng, ya pengen pulang.
Methane's an invisible threat at Bantar Gebang. The gas comes from rotting food, wood, and paper. When there's too much of it, people can suffocate. And it can cause deadly eruptions. In 2005, trapped methane exploded at a dump site in Java and triggered an avalanche that buried dozens of homes and killed 143 people. Most of them were scavengers living near the landfill. But nothing stops Rasidin from coming to work.
Ya pernah kehujanan, keanginan, kadang-kadang mau pulang aja hujan, ayo macok terus nyari emberan.
He makes around $25 a week. That's about a third of Indonesia's minimum wage, but still more than what farmers make.
Kalau bapak sebenarnya lebih baik mulung daripada nggak makan.
Waduh, kayaknya lelah banget ini.
Iya, capean bos.
Panas. 14 kilo.
14 kilo ya? Oh, iya. Ya udah, lumayan. Berapa sih harganya?
Rasidin sells his goods to middlemen like Adi, who then sells them to another trash buyer. As many as 20,000 families here depend on Bantar Gebang to make a living. This land used to be mostly forest and rice fields until the 1980s. Trash has been piling up ever since.
Ya, bagaimana berhentinya kalau masih begini ceritanya mah? Gak ada berhentinya, kecuali kalau udah tua baru nggak boleh sama anak. Kalau sekarang juga nggak boleh, emang nggak boleh, cuman terpaksa, masa mengharapin aja anak.
Rasidin has 5 children, and he dreams they might one day make it out of here.
Ada yang jadi pemulung, orang tua pemulung, anaknya jadi pemulung. Ada yang bawa alat berat, ada yang bawa alat nyupir sampah, ada alat berat ada, yang masih sekolah ada 2, yang udah kerja ada, belum pada sukses.
Ya dongain aja Bu, biar Bapak biar selamat usahanya.
Ya udah masuk.
And Indan has a message for the wealthy.
Maaf sama orang-orang kaya ini. Kalau beli makanan jangan banyak-banyak. Secukupnya aja buat anaknya. Jangan dibuang, sayang. Jangan dibuang dulu, kasih orang-orang yang susah seperti aku ini.